Look at this for a start. Welcome everybody to our afternoon live sunset safari. My name is Byron and on camera this afternoon is David. We have my colleague Jay. Chelsea in the FC this afternoon. They are going to be sending us your questions. Don't forget, we're on a live safari. It's great to have you with us. We are situated in the Juma Game Reserve, which is in the greater at hashtag Safari Live, or email us on questions at wildearth.com. This beautiful herd of elephant at the moment. It's a wonderful, wonderful winter's afternoon. It's about 24 degrees. Really, really warm afternoon. And we've headed out, and the first thing we bumped into was this herd of elephant, not far from the camp. And they've been standing here for about 20 minutes, completely relaxed. Happily feeding, and this young elephant has been entertaining us learning to use its trunk. It looks like it keeps trying to pick off the leaves off that very sharp acacia tree, the thorn tree that it is standing in front of. We had a really wonderful morning with a lot of activity. We had a leopard with cubs. It was all going well for us this morning. A lot of luck. James had most of the luck, but we did get to see the female leopard with the two cubs, which was great because it was the first time I had seen them. Excuse me, this is such a great start. I just love elephants. I love spending time with them. And to get them so relaxed and feeding and walking around us. Hey, wherever you are around the world, or if you have just started your day, I hope it is a great one. And hopefully you get to join us and send us questions and spend some time with us on our safari. You are seeing as we see it. Oh, look at this young one playing in front of us. Is he throwing the branch and twisting it around its trunk? That is really great. It takes them about 2 years before they really learn how to use the drink. They use it to suck up water and pour it into their mouth so that they can drink. It has a lot of uses. I'm assuming that is the matriarch. You can hear it breaking those branches. So Ashley has asked us a question regarding the dry season that we are having at the moment. We fall as we usually get, and Ashley would like to know what measures are taken to try and control the drought or control the animal population, or is there culling? Ashley, at the moment, no, there's no culling. We try not to cull animals unless it is really, really necessary. Especially within the greater Kruger, there is a natives, the animal populations and so on. And it has been going for a very long time. That is why, you know, these areas, Kruger Park, for example, has been going since the early 1900s. Oh, sorry. Yeah, early 1900s, late 1800s. But that very soon stopped, and the animals flourished within their natural habitat. At the moment, though, there are certain water holes throughout the game reserve that holes into certain areas to make sure that there is water around for animals. But some of the rivers, most of the rivers actually still have water in them, and they will hopefully still carry some water through the dry season. But as we move into June, we have a bit of a drought heading our way, but animals adapt to the surroundings and the conditions that they are in. They will still manage to find water, so I think they should be okay. But as I said, there's food around, they should be okay. But drought is inevitable. It's nature's way, I think, of balancing things out. And for nature, sometimes it is hard, and you do see animals struggling in drought, but it's natural selection, and that is one of the things about being out here, is that we try not to interfere, even though there are water holes there. For a bit longer, we don't really have a choice, they're in the road at the moment. But while we do that, let's cross over to James and let him welcome you to our afternoon drive.
Good afternoon, everybody, and a very warm welcome to this, the afternoon drive. I was trying to think of the date, but I can't for the life of me think of it. Brian? 29th of June. Wonderful to have you with us on this Wednesday afternoon. It is a beautiful afternoon. It is 24 degrees Celsius, 76 degrees Fahrenheit. Brian is on camera. He's got a t-shirt on, no jacket, and a beautiful thumb. What is the thumb today?
Existential dread thumb.
An existential dread thumb. How wonderful for a Wednesday afternoon. In the final control, you've probably heard we have Kirsten McLennan-Smith, helped by Chelsea Byrne. But we're not alone sitting where we are here. Oh no. Look over there. Just coming down the main trunk of that tree, you might be able to see a little leopard. Isn't that cool? We've just driven up here. We stopped the car because Brian said they were around here somewhere today, looked to the left, and there they were. Now, in theory, we can't be viewing these cubs. We can't kind of follow them if Mum isn't here. They're both in this tree, by the way. I can see them both. One in the fork, the one you're looking at, and then that's the one that, yeah. So you've got both. I don't know where Mum is. I suspect she's off hunting still. She may have killed something. She also seems to like a bit of downtime away from them now and again. Anyway, what we can do, I'm not going to drive off road for them because Mum isn't here. There's nothing wrong with us stopping on the road, though, and we are on the road, so we're just going to ease forward and have a look at them. They're both obviously very comfortable up in the tree there. Mum might be nearby, you know. I haven't seen her. And I am again interested by the keen on each other. They don't spend any time actually playing like lion cubs might. You've got the shot there, Brian. Yep. And so the lion cubs that we've seen so often play with each other, and leopard cubs do. You know, I don't have a vast experience of leopard play with each other, but these chaps don't do a great deal of playing. They seem to be, the play behavior that happens seems to happen with their mum. And I think that's quite interesting. That's Charlotte we're looking at, with the brown eyes. And somebody said to me yesterday that they thought she also had a wow across the front of her forehead like her mum. I don't see that myself, but I can sort of see the W. She's such a cute little thing, that. And this tree is something called an albizia, or false thorn tree. Very, very seldom do they get anything like the size over here. And you can see it's almost an evergreen, but not quite. All right, we're going to sit here for a little while. I don't think these cubs are going anywhere. Let's head across to Byron and a very...
Jeez, James has been so lucky today. We saw Karula this morning. I told him where to go and have a look. Hang down. Look at this baby right there. Oh my word, that is amazing. It's fantastic. What a start. James with the leopard and the cubs. We've got this incredible elephant sighting. His elephant lying down. Email is so close to us. Really, really incredible. But look at that little calf lying down. Instagram and Facebook for all the Safari Live viewers to see, those who might be missing the show right now. That little one is so cute. Very, very cute. Often get to see them lying down, but they will rest. Looks like it's sleeping, but it's just resting. It's just lying down, resting a little bit. The female is right next to it, so it's feeling very, very. So we're not disturbing them. I haven't moved the vehicle at all. I've just sat quietly. David and I have just sat here. The female's actually moved closer to us. That calf has felt completely comfortable to lie down. This is a... Looks like that female is also resting a little bit. Just standing quietly, standing very still. Deborah, armchair traveler, would like to know if the play behavior still continues without the vehicles here, or does it occur more when the vehicles are here? I think definitely when the vehicles aren't around, they probably feel a little bit more comfortable, and you might get more play behavior from the younger elephant. Natural. We're not influencing them at all. And I say that because for an elephant to go and lie down and feel so comfortable definitely means that they are not worried about us at all. And that's completely natural behavior. They'll come and sniff around and look at us. But but this behavior that we are seeing now, not necessarily being playful, but just resting, is wonderful. See how this female is flapping her ears. Now, that is not an aggressive sign at all. She's purely flapping her ears to cool her body down. So within the ears, and if you look very closely, you might be able to see it. There are a lot of veins. Do you see that? A lot of veins running through the ears. And the ears are very thin. So what happens is, while she's flapping her ears, she cools. It takes about 9 to 11 minutes for the blood to circulate from those ears through the body. And by her cooling down the blood slightly, that's often done also to cool themselves down or to get rid of some insects that might be sitting on their backs or around them. But that flapping the ears is to cool the blood in the ears, and, or does help them cool down a little bit in the heat. In summer, you'll see them standing flapping those ears constantly because it is much, much warmer. It's a beautiful temperature now. It's not too hot, but it is a lovely warm day. Kim would like to ask, why are the young elephant so wrinkly? So a lot of moisture which is held within the folds of the skin. And obviously these younger elephant still have a lot of growing to do, so the skin grows quite quick and to have wrinkles in the skin. You can see the nails very clear, very, very interesting. So they've got toenails, but the bottom of the feet, very soft pads, thick padding. the female just gave a very low frequency call, and that I think was to communicate to the youngster, right, you've rested enough, you need to get up. Very interesting. Taking branches and pushing trees over. James has got the leopard cubs up in a tree.
George and Charlotte, our young royalty, are lurking in its boughs. Now, we moved very slightly, and Charlotte was not in the least bit scandalized, and so we'll just sit here for a little while and not around, but that's okay, they're leopard cubs, so they're allowed to be flat cat, as it were. Far more entertaining than watching a lion, say, reclining in the shade. What'd you say, Brian? Much less messy. And I imagine they'll get bored eventually and they'll start moving around. Don't you think it's interesting that they don't play around with each other? I think that's quite interesting. I have questions at wildearth.tv. Send us your impressions. Oh, George is coming. I see George moving towards us. Just a sort of flash of... While we wait and see if Georgie doesn't come down to his sister, I just wanted to address something about something called embryonic diapause. And embryonic diapause is the process by which animals delay the implantation of an embryo, can delay the birth of their offspring. And it's something that we get asked about a lot, and it's something that I just wanted to clear up. Impala, and once it is, you know, come to term at 7 months, it cannot then be held inside the uterus for a further 2 or 3 months until the rains come. It's just simply not biologically possible. At the same time, there's this incredible thing that I didn't know about that Judy H. sent me some information on today called embryonic diapause. And there are a number of animals, the marsupials being a notable example, that are able to create the zygote. The zygote is basically the four-celled new organism, once fertilizations take place, has taken place, and then it becomes an embryo and it stops at that stage and does not implant in the endometrial wall of the uterus. Then it can be delayed. So that embryo can be held before it's implanted and it will not develop any further. I guess it's a little bit like, not to, you know, to be a little bit crude, it's a little bit like keeping an in vitro embryo. And so that was fascinating. Thank you, Judy H., for that. But impala, as far as I'm aware, are unable to do that. They do not predict the environmental conditions that are going to persist when they come to term. And what's given rise to this great legend, of course, that impala are able to do this, is the fact that there is a second impala breeding season, and that is in February. And so I think a lot of people have misinterpreted that. Anyway, those young February babies and the November babies better watch out when George and Charlotte get to November. They will then be, what will they be, Brian? Hang on, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 months old. They'll be just around and they're okay. They'll be a year old. They'll definitely be big enough to take a newborn impala. And Brian and I were just saying sort of... not semi-facetiously, but in jest, what do you think would happen if we walked to the bottom of the tree and kind of tried to pluck one of them out? And we found it amusing to consider what would happen if, you know, Brian had Charlotte on his lap and I had George on the dashboard. When Karula came knocking about the corner, how she'd react if we were tickling them. and the point of that discussion, of course, is that it's entirely hypothetical, but you would never get that close to these cubs. They are wild. They look very cute. They look very sweet. They look like if you gave them a cuddle, they'd purr on you. They would not. They've got sharp little teeth, vicious little claws, and you would know all about it. And on that basis, Brian and I decided that we would not climb up into the tree and fetch the cubs. And many viewers, thank you very much, all of you, for your comments, saying that you also think it's a bit odd that they don't play together. I don't, like I say, I don't have a massive experience, you know, born to one mother and their interactions with each other, but I suspect what it is the fact that they are not social cats, of course. Leopards are not social, and as soon as they hit puberty, they will go off on their own. Lion cubs, which are social, they are social from the beginning. They play with each other, they growl, they sort of jump all over each other, and those lessons of coordination and play and hunting are meted out or are played much more that they play with their mother. And Trump is a buffoon. You have my vote for the best Twitter handle there is at the moment. Trump is a buffoon. Thank you. I don't, because their hunting is largely instinctual, and I also think they'll play with their mother. You know, they'll stalk her, and they'll jump on her and bite her tail and chase her. It'll be interesting to see how that plays out. Maybe they'll start playing with each other. I mean, Charlotte is now looking for George. Could it be possible, well, first of all, you preface it with, this might sound crazy, but could it be possible that these leopards have got different fathers? And Betty, we don't know for sure if it is possible. We know that in a number of species, it is possible. It happens with leopards. We do know that they mate with more than one male per estrus cycle. We don't know if Karula mated with more than just Tingana during the course of her estrus cycle. But Betty, we're hoping that some of that, you know, we've collected a whole lot of dung from many, many leopards around the Sabi Sands, and that's all being analyzed for DNA. And we're hoping very much. And I mean, really, I know that I've done it myself, but we've all kind of looked at leopards and said, oh, well, you know, he looks like so-and-so. So-and-so must be his father. I don't, unfortunately, believe that we're able to accurately do that. And so I think only the Sandile, for example, I see him, I see his eyes, and I think maybe he's the offspring of Mvula, but I just don't know. All right, let's go across to Byron. He's got a pig to show you.
That's right, I do have a pig, a warthog. Looks like a small family. There are a few more off to the left that are just hiding behind a thicket, but we can see that one. Looked like a big female, they did look like a male with them. And then some younger there we go. Really beautiful, beautiful antelope there in Yala. Another one is following it. Should come through there shortly. There we go. Yala, and these are all males. It's interesting to see so many Yala males together. But they look a little younger. I suppose they are adults. I think they've still got 1 or 2 years to grow before they're ready. We also have some kudu in the area. I'm trying to see if the kudu stick their heads out. The kudu and impala. So there's a lot going on here. It's wonderful. Water.
How do you like?
Kudu, impala, a lot of different antelope species. Obviously just a nice area for them to be feeding in the afternoon. Going to move forward a little bit for us quickly. There's another Nyala. Hang on, we'll get through the gap here. Pell has asked us, do warthogs have a leader in the group? Well, a group of warthogs is usually just the family, so it'll most likely be either the mother or the large male that is with the family, if there is a male there. Generally, with warthog, it will be the female with the piglets in a group, and the males are solitary until they meet up with a group of females. There we go, there's the impala we spoke about, just behind the Nyala, and there's a lot going on through there, but so with the sorry, with the warthog, it's the mother that will lead the youngsters and the piglets, and then the males are generally by themselves until they're looking to mate with the females, then they'll meet up with the group. They may spend some time with the group at times, but generally it is the female that controls the group of warthog, because they are family. So I just want to see if I can find you one of those kudu quickly. There we go, through there, there's the kudu. It's a young male kudu. Interesting to see him by himself. But one of the other reasons why you might keep a lookout for any potential predators, and they will warn each other if there is any danger. So it's not unusual to find these antelope in the same area. And also, both the Inyala and the kudu are strict browsers, which means they only feed off leaves of trees. There's a female kudu walking through there. So they only feed off leaves of trees. The impala are mixed feeders. They will graze leaves. It depends on the time of year and it depends what food is available. So that's probably why all these antelope are in the same area. There must be good browsing for them at the moment around here. Lovely to see so many different animals in the east. And while I do that, let's cross back to James and see what those leopard cubs are up to.
We did move very slightly, everybody, but the leopards didn't move it. He's now searching it. Oh, he's so tired, poor little George, he's so tired. Excuse me, I can't help myself when I see these things. I sense that the viewers are semi-tolerant of the names I've given these cubs. Some think they're quite good, some undoubtedly think that they're utterly ridiculous, and they will not be known as George and Charlotte for long. Now, as the other vehicles get mobile, everybody, we're going to have to move out of here, simply because we can't actually establish a proper sighting here without Mum. But I'm prepared to view them here. You can see we're having absolutely no effect on them whatsoever. They're fast asleep, and they're next to the road, and we're not bashing around next to them. And there aren't other vehicles coming in and out. And so we'll spend a little bit of time with them, and I think everyone's going to start getting mobile in about 10 minutes or so, and then we're just going to move out of here and carry on and see if we can find Karula. Perhaps. And as I say that, people are starting to get mobile. Kevin, you want to know how far Mum will travel? Well, you know, she's travelled. Last time she left somewhere around, yes, I remember exactly now, they were left somewhere around Treehouse Dam, which is about 300 metres to the south of us, so about 900 feet. Which is probably a good, 4 kilometres as the crow flies, so a round trip of about 8 km, 5 miles. So that was quite a big one, and I think she went off and did a bit of hunting and a bit of territory marking, because her territory able to climb trees and look after themselves a little bit better now. You can see that they're completely relaxed in the tree, totally safe up there. So she could range a long way from here. She could easily range onto Torchwood, kill there, and then come back and get them. Lovely to hear from you, and I hope that you keep watching and keep talking to us. Chitra, you want to know what role the father plays, and I love this question, and it comes from all sorts of human cultures where we know that our dads play an enormous role in the role of mammal fathers in the lives of their youngsters. Unfortunately, Tengana, who we think is the father of both of these little chaps, is not going to have any further effect on their life. If he does meet them, he'll probably be fairly offhand about it. I don't think he'll be very affectionate to them, but he won't harm them. But his indirect parenting effect is to protect the territory that he is in, and therefore that their mother is in. Unrelated male leopards are a major killer of little cubs, and so that's what's going to happen. Okay, we're going to have to head out of here now because everyone's starting to get mobile, following Karula shortly. Okay, wasn't that one? Alrighty, let's get out of here. I'm just, the radio is unbelievable how many people there are talking there. Okay, let's go and see. Now, Karula went wandering down here at some stage, and so she'll come probably, I mean, wherever she kills from, she'll take a direct route straight back towards here. Ooh. Now, what we're going to do is go towards Biffle's Hook Dam via the route that Karula went. I've just heard on the radio that there were tracks of baby lions in that area, so maybe we'll be very lucky there. Wouldn't that be nice? Lion cubs and leopard cubs in one drive? I think that'd be awesome. Hello, Earl in Tampa. I'll get back to you right now. Stations 2, Wild Earth vehicles are mobile. One had a herd of elephants around Weird Teller Dam. I went to check for Karula. She's not on site. Cubs are in a Albizia tree, but Mum is not there, so I left. And yeah, we're driving Ingwe Alley. We'll go to Twin. Earl in Tampa. You are interested in the whole drive, and then this morning I went off to Cheetah Plains like Byron's doing now, and he will probably drive, so the more we see, the less we seem to drive, because obviously you stop and things, and therefore the longer it is that we're going to be driving along, on a very kind of lengthy drive. Keep an eye out under all the bushes for Karula, and while she does, if she does kill, she will certainly come back to fetch the cubs. She does take time out. I've noticed that too. Oop, there goes my microphone. Hang on a second, I'm going to have to fix this very happily. Please excuse the scraping and scratching, everybody. I'm sure it sounds dreadful. Very irritating. I'm so sorry. Okay, I think we're done. There we are. Right. Let's try and keep it taped in. I might have to tape it to my head. It won't be very nice. I talk like this, my voice does not change in volume, do you see? And when I put my scarf on, you don't hear ruffling and shaking. All you hear is it's a nice thought for the afternoon. It is yet another beautiful afternoon. It was a misty, eerie morning today, and it's cleared up into a wonderfully, it's been quite warm. Maybe there'll be some elephants or some buffalo wandering down that way. Hello, Len. Len, you say when is the best time to come on safari? Len, there isn't a best time. Or the first one is to say that sort of the rainy season months, November, January, February, very hot, very around, so it's a really kind of verdant, life-filled time. March, April, May, as we go into kind of the autumn. Well, it's still as green as less otherwise, so that's that time. Then we get the time we're in now, June, July, August. And that's the kind of winter months when it's quite cold in the mornings, but not too bad at all, especially if you're from Canada. You'll think it's positively off the trees. Everything's starting to get very dry, and so the animals are concentrating around the dry season. And that the game viewing is spectacular because the leaves on the trees have all fallen off. So there's not a great deal of foliage around the place. The water is very concentrated, so big herds of animals head towards the waterhole. Used to kind of verdant green boreal forests of Canada in the summertime, and then I know it's very snowy there in the wintertime, but if you're not used to the dry, and it can be harsh, but if you're used to it, it's just really beautiful. So those are the times of the year, and each one is nice. Each one's got a... Thank you for that, Len. Now we're going to go down into the great valley of the Mulwati drainage line. Raging torrent. Hopefully we'll get through. Do you think we will, Brian?
I hope so. Whew. It's going to be tough.
It's a tough one getting through the water, even in this car. You can see the vegetation getting thicker as we get closer to this vast raging torrent, and if you listen carefully, that's scary just to listen to. Hold on tight, put your weatherproofs on, get your books into the weatherproof bag. I'm not sure where that came from, and I apologize profusely. While Kirsten says we can link to buy,
so it sounds like James is losing his mind. I think he's got a little bit of heat stroke, actually. He took us out for an afternoon run just before we went out and dry. It's always good to exercise out here, but running in this dry heat, I think all of us regretted it soon afterwards. So, planes at the moment, no luck just yet. But noon, I'm hoping we get something that's come down to drink. We'll be there shortly, I think. Because again, this is an area I'm not ready. Oh, there's a bird calling that I'd love to show you. Let me just see. So, Tara, the last time we saw cheetah on the drive was this morning. James found some cheetah. He saw two big males. Beautiful males, and we heading towards that area to see this afternoon. I'm hoping they haven't moved off too far. I'm trying to see. This bird is calling that I would love to show you. It is called a red-crested koran. And let me just see. They're very difficult to spot. They are ground birds. See, okay. Now, there is. Let's just see if he calls again. So, let me show you a picture of what this bird looks like first. The red. Crested koran, that bird over there. It's got a very high-pitched whistle, but there's a little trick. What was he going to call? No. So there's a little trick that I'd like to think it works. I've done it a few times. They've got a very distinct call. It starts with a clicking sound, and then they go off and they do this whistle. Something like that. And this bird then shoots up into the air, straight up. It basically does a somersault. So it rolls back in the air, wings open, and then it floats back down to the ground and uses its wings as a parachute and lands. It is amazing to see. Now, usually when they call and they whistle, they do it. Some guides have different theories on it, but the tapping on the vehicle, a little tap like this. So. That occasionally helps to get the birds curious. And I think it's because it sounds similar to that clicking sound that they do in the beginning of it. Let me see. Let's try and knock once or twice. I'm not going to spend too much time here, but let's just see. Watching, keep watching. It's very close. It's very close. It's in the thicket. Okay, it's whistling back. It's whistling back. So we're getting a reaction out of it. Come on. If this works, I am going to be so impressed. There's another. Come on. It's not whistling back now. Just wait. It is. I'm sure it's going to work. Come on. It's got to. I think that frame is perfect there, David, because if it shoots out, it might just go straight up. There's a whistle back again. My fingers are getting a little sore now. Just giving it a bit of time. I don't really think it is mating season. It's usually the males that do it to attract a female. Okay, you see what he's done? He's come right out close to us. He's on the ground. Just moving through there. You got him?
Yep.
There we go. There he is. So he's come right out to investigate. Beautiful, but you see how well camouflaged they are. Beautiful red crested koran. Wait, you're going to get a good glimpse. There we go. Look at that. Okay, come on. I don't think he's going to do it, but it's wonderful to see. I mean, he came and investigated a little bit, but it doesn't look like he wants to do a display for us, unfortunately. I'm going to try once more. Let's see if we get another whistle. Not interested in doing that full display for us, but he was whistling back. Definitely interested, but I think he saw myself and David and thought, nah, this is not worth displaying for. That is, as we drove past, I heard it, but obviously through the thicket, it's very, very difficult to see. So I'm glad he came out to investigate and see what the knocking was, but we just didn't get him shooting up into the air and doing that display for us. But you never know. He mace into the air. I've seen it happen a few times. Let's just see. I'm not interested in displaying for us today. But great to see him, and I'm glad he came and investigated to see what that sound was. But we're obviously just not pretty enough for him. Okay, we're about to get to this water hole. Let's see what's here. Oh, what have we got there? A huge herd of buffalo. Fantastic. Wow, this is a big herd. I can see buffalo extending all the way through the back, but they're right up ahead approaching this waterhole for a drink. So I think we're going to get a lot of activity here now. Oh, beautiful. Beautiful view of these buffalo drinking. Wow, some of them are right in the water. And look at that. Just as I thought, a lovely dry or warm, dry afternoon. And animals will come down to drink any time of the day, whenever they're thirsty, any time. And our timing was just perfect today. We're just lucky with our timing. And this whole herd of buffalo came down to drink. Do you see they've gone right into the water? This is great. They're still coming. A herd of buffalo like this is predominantly females and young. There are dominant bulls within a herd, but there are a lot of males splitting away from these herds. They don't like moving around as much. These herds can cover huge distances looking for food and water. The old males cover a large distance. But if a herd like this does come through and passes those big old bulls, then those bulls will definitely join the herd for a short period of time, be 2, 3, 4, up to 8 or 10 sometimes, old bulls that stay together. Oh, and there's such beautiful light now too, this afternoon sunlight. So I can hear some lapwings, blacksmith lapwings and crowned lapwings in the back. And they're calling. As these buffalo have walked through, they've obviously disturbed those lapwings. Those lapwings nest on the ground. I spoke about it the other day, but for those viewers who didn't hear it, I've seen these birds standing their ground with a buffalo or an elephant coming straight towards them, and they open their wings. And they'll stand and scream at the buffalo and elephant and force them around where their nests are on the ground. It's incredible. I've seen one actually pick a buffalo's nose. The buffalo stood back and quickly moved around. It's incredible to see the birds react like that. So I heard them calling. They're potentially trying to keep buffalo away. They also go and they dive bomb them. They fly around and they try and move these big animals away from their nests or their chicks so that they don't hurt them or break their eggs for that matter. Hear the sound of these buffalo swishing through the water. Flushing of that water, a wonderful sound, wonderful, wonderful sound. Liz has just said the dinner bell has been rung. Where are the lions? Yeah, imagine a pride of lions walk through here now. Could be very interesting. But I think in the warmth of the afternoon like we have at the moment, lions are possibly resting. I'm going to sit with these buffalo a little bit, see what they do, which direction they go. Let's go back to James and see what he is up to.
Everybody, we are eye level with the hippopotamus at Biffleshook Dam. And to keep watching him. And we've parked here, we've gone down into the new part of the dam, which is lower down than the old part, so we're almost at a full opportunity to look at him. I was going to look at him from the top of the dam, and Brian said, no, let's go down closer. Now that is a warning, there's no question. He's saying to us, not that happy with you being there. If we sit and we're nice and quiet, I think he'll be okay. But I may have to reverse fairly smartly if he starts coming this way. I'm just going to be quiet.